I'd like to welcome Prime Minister Fredrik Reinfeldt here to government buildings on his first visit as Prime Minister to Ireland. Fredrik's been here on many occasions over the years, obviously we've had a very good discussion for the last period. I'd like to say that the Prime Minister has been a very constructive leader at the European Council meetings since I joined the European Council, and in his discussions in regard to the MFF, he had been very supportive of getting a deal through in a constructive fashion, and I commend him for that. We both share the view that Europe can do so much more on jobs and so much more on growth, and this is part of the three pillars that Ireland has put forward for our presidency of stability, growth and jobs, and we both share that view very strongly. One issue that we did discuss was the question of youth unemployment, the scourge right across Europe, and how we might deal with that, and we don't want to see the €6 billion allocated in the MFF wasted in any way. So we discussed how that might be done through an enhanced single market, for example in the digital area and the area of integration of services and so on. I made the point to the Prime Minister that we prioritise the single market measures, which he supports very strongly, e-signatures, measures on ensuring mutual recognition and professional qualifications. We're of the same view there. We also discussed the opportunities for trade. Sweden is a trading nation that will arise from the imprimatur now given by both Europe and the United States to the commencement of discussions dealing with trade between both blocs. We had some talks about the current issues in the area of EMU and where that's headed. And while it's important for the euro area that the euro countries draw closer together, we've made it very clear that because of our understanding of this, that the non-euro countries should not be left outside those discussions, and Ireland's presidency will see that they're absolutely fully involved. We had some discussion about banking union, and of course we discussed the MFF and the agreement that was reached at the European Council. And I want to say this, that the mandate given to Ireland's presidency now is to negotiate with the European Parliament to get approval and their consent to this. Prime Minister Fredrik has already spoken to the Swedish MEPs about this, and we're not, as presidency, in the business of changing the MFF. We will discuss with the Parliament and the sectors the flexibility and own resource question, but we want to get a approval and consent for the MFF and move on, because we've got a lot of things to do. In that sense, I welcome Fredrik's visit here to Ireland. I've given him our little book, which shows the changes that Ireland has been involved in here and that we've been making over the past period, which has increased our competitiveness, make us more attractive for inward investment. And I spoke to him about our action plan for jobs, which we launched today down the city. So I now ask Prime Minister to say a few words.
Yeah.
He's heading down for Trinity College to give a lecture there in a short time. Thank you, Fredrik.
No, thank you very much. I'm very glad to be here in Ireland today. We had very good discussions. We enjoy excellent relations between our two countries. Well, I should say so in advance of the World Cup qualification game that is coming up. So as of now, we have very good, excellent relations. We are like-minded on many issues. We support very thoroughly the Irish presidency work. And I think that Ireland is an excellent example of the reform strategy that is needed throughout Europe to increase competitiveness. We understand that, as was also the case in Sweden in the 90s, it is very tough, it is often criticized, but the alternative is actually to see a massive loss of jobs and to lose out on competitiveness, which is throughout Europe still a problem. And I think that there is a lot to learn from the Irish example, and therefore it's been very rewarding to go through this together with the Taoiseach. So thank you very much for receiving me.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. For question for Mr. Reinfeldt, did you discuss Sweden's bilateral loans to Ireland under the bailout, and has any consideration been given to the extension of the maturity on those loans? Thank you.
No, we did not discuss that into details. The Taoiseach thanked Sweden for this bilateral support. I think it's very important to say that a lot of this is, of course, now discussed inside the Eurozone linked to the ESM, but Sweden has been in bilateral loans both for Ireland, but also done so for Iceland and for Latvia. But we have not discussed it today, and I think it should not be done like this. So we'll probably get back at other time to those discussions.
We did thank Sweden for their very early granting of that 0.6 billion loan to us here at the.
Lars Larsson from the Swedish news agency TT. What advice have you given each other when it comes to tackling youth employment, unemployment?
Well, first of all, we were happy to support each other at the European Council in getting 6 billion put in there for dealing with youth unemployment. I actually discussed a number of measures that apply in Sweden in terms of apprenticeships and opportunities for young people. I explained to the Prime Minister some of the schemes that apply here in Ireland, but this is an issue that we're both concerned about, to see that the monies that are allocated through the MFF are actually spent to the best effect in giving young people opportunities like that. So there will be plenty of other opportunity, Lars, for more detailed discussions about the various schemes that might work very effectively. We're not interested in just putting on courses that young people can say, I've done a course. What we want to do is provide opportunities where that can translate into jobs actually being created and jobs filled.
Yeah. What we feel in Sweden, and that is known to our Swedish journalist, is a combination that they ask of a lot of education and experience at the same time. And what we often find is that young people might not have followed through on their education and lack of experience. So, of course, how do you solve that? Well, you get better educational system, but you also introduce some kind of apprenticeship schemes, which we have seen throughout Europe being quite successful. And that is what we are trying to achieve also more broadly in Sweden.
Thank you.
A question for Prime Minister Reinfeldt. The Taoiseach spoke about keeping Sweden involved in negotiations that are going on within the Eurozone. Are you concerned about greater integration in the Eurozone, leaving countries outside behind? And what's your view of David Cameron's call for the repatriation of certain powers from the EU?
Well, we've been a strong supporter of a lot of the schemes that have come through during our discussions latest years, the EU 2020 facing very much on competitiveness, benchmarking throughout Europe, the European semester, the two-pack and everything that is now in place. We think that we have the tools of making a better competitive Europe, but also sustainable public finances. Having said that, it is a question, of course, when a lot of the issues discussed relates to the euro as a currency, that Sweden do not have the euro as a currency. And I think that what we are trying, and with good support of our good friend Enda, is that we think that we should try to keep a balance that where every 27, soon to be 28, have an influence, and that we do not relate everything to the Eurozone, even though we understand and respect that sometimes they need meetings of their own. So I think that's a balancing act. And to my mind, a lot of the problems that we face in Europe is not so much linked to the euro as a currency, but more to lack of competitiveness, financial crisis, restructuring of the world economy, and therefore should be dealt with all 27 members present.
Taoiseach, just a domestic question. The Gardaí's work to rule actions taking place from today. Surely this should have some impact on pay talks?
Well, as I said on many occasions, the place to deal with the pay talks and the negotiations is at the table where those discussions are taking place. And I would respectfully request again that the Garda Representative Association would see to it that they go back in there and have the full opportunity to articulate their concerns and the issues that are causing discussion for them. And we hope that these discussions can conclude in a professional and a proper fashion. And as I say, that's where they should be conducted.
Final question, Joe.
Joe Brennan, Bloomberg News. A question for Prime Minister Reinfeldt. Are you concerned about the current valuation of the krona? And is there anything that the government can do, particularly given that the Risks Bank isn't particularly concerned about the way the valuation has gone in recent times?
Well, to my mind, the Swedish currency, the krona, is market valued, and therefore I should take very careful note not to interact as if it was me telling the markets what should be the price of our currency. I can reflect on the fact that for many years, when I started in politics, the complaint in Sweden was that our currency was very weak and that it de facto devaluated the wages that we got in value. So now when we live at a time when our currency is very strong, we should of course remember these discussions. It's fantastic nowadays for Swedish tourists to travel around the world because the currency in itself is so strong. But what you then need to do is to increase measures in other fields so that you do not lose out on competitiveness. For instance, we lowered our corporate tax on 1st of January from 26.3% down to 22%. That's one kind of measure that we could do, trying to balance the fact that we now have a very strong Swedish krona.
Thanks very much indeed.